There are people operating in positions in the church who are not called by Jesus to be there. They don't know the power of Jesus. There are positions based upon agendas of men. Some are in high positions, entered all across denominations, telling people that Jesus did not rise from the grave. They are teaching that the resurrection is just a metaphor. We aren't supposed to believe it literally. What intelligent person can believe in a dead person? Got up. The moral code, they're saying, of what Jesus taught is good enough to help us to be better people. To them, Jesus is no different than any other religious figure. They are sent, I'm going to say it outright, by Satan to take away our faith, our children's faith, our up-and-coming ministers' faith, all from within the church. And the church of this age has allowed heresy, sexual immorality, fornication, adultery, homosexuality. And the leaders of our church and many churches are telling people sin is okay. It's okay. After all, God says, come as you are. Yet we fail to tell people that God never said to any one of us, stay as you are. God is calling all of us to come higher, come to be embraced by the changing power of God's grace. Not grace that gives freedom to sin, but grace that gives freedom from sin. Romans 6:15 says, what then shall we sin because we are not under the law but under grace? By no means. 1 Corinthians 6:9 and 10 says, do you not know that wrongdoers will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived, neither the sexual immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who have sex with men, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor slanderers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. 1 Corinthians 6, 9 and 10. Revelation 21, 9, it says, but the cowardly, the unbelieving, the vile, the murderers, the sexual immoral, those who practice magic arts, the idolaters and all liars, they will be consigned to the fiery lake of burning sulfur. This is the second death, Revelation 21, 9. Now that passage in itself, it gives us reason why we must fish for souls. We aren't merely drawing people into social clubs. We are saving people from hell's fire by preaching the truth in the power of Jesus' death and resurrection. Everyone who fishes for souls is not fishing for Jesus. Watch out for those who produce the power of that name, Jesus. Watch out for those who tell you that what Scripture says is sinful and deplorable to God is okay for you. It's not that bad. Watch out for those who encourage you to feel comfortable in sin. Comfort is the opposite of conviction. When we encounter the presence of the Holy Spirit, the conviction of the Spirit makes us very uncomfortable. Peter was so uncomfortable in Jesus' presence that although Jesus never mentioned anything about sin, Peter said, depart from me. In Jesus' presence was this sudden awareness of Peter's reality. Smith Wigglesworth told the story. He said he was on the train, and this person was next to him shaking. And he turned to him and said, who are you? You convict me of my sins. We can carry the presence of God so much on our life that people feel something different about you that makes them convicted to want to be better. Beware of people who attempt to take away our awareness, our God consciousness. They strategically do it one idea at a time, one sermon at a time, one book at a time, one television commercial at a time, and everywhere you look, there's this great effort revelation. And you have to know that you're sick in order to go to the doctor to ask for help. 2 Corinthians 11, chapter 14 and 15 verses, "For Satan himself masquerades as an angel of light." It's not surprising then if his servants also masquerade as angels of righteousness, their end will be what their action deserves. Matthew 7:15 says, "Watch out for false prophets. They come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ferocious wolves." 2 Peter 3:9, it says, "The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance." We are exposing people to God's passion, God's love, and God's grace. How God doesn't want any one of us to go to hell. The great evangelical scripture, John 3:16-17. "God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not die but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved." The same Jesus who loves us calls us to himself while he knows that we are sinners. Romans 5:8, "But God demonstrates his own love for us in this, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." Jesus Christ dies for us and calls us to trust him, because he doesn't want us to die in sin. Jesus knows he's the only way to perfection. He's the only way to the peace that we're seeking. Some are set free the moment they confess Jesus as their Lord and Savior, completely free from addictions. Others, it takes time, but the bottom line, whatever process we're in, so long as we're trusting Jesus, we're okay. Therefore, God exalted Jesus to the highest place and gave Jesus the name above every name, Philippians 2:9. The men of the church takes emphasis off of the authority of that name and off of the authority of Scripture. It ceases to be a church.